Okay, it's time to begin. Welcome to my session. So let's start the present slideshow. Welcome to my presentation. My name is Akira Ajisaka, and I'd like to talk about HDFS upgrade from 2.7 to 3.3 and enabling router-based federation in our largest production cluster. Let me introduce about myself. My name is Akira Ajisaka, and I'm an Apache Hadoop committer and PMC member, and I am working for Yahoo Japan. We have very large data in HDFS, and the data is rapidly increasing. So I am developing Apache Hadoop to break the limitation of the data that HDFS can store, and I am developing Apache Hadoop to reduce the operational costs. I like bouldering, competitive programming, and distributed systems such as Apache Hadoop and its ecosystems. I will upload this slide to the slide share in a few days and announce this in my Twitter account and Apache Hadoop mailing lists. So please follow me if you are interested in me. This account. So here is the agenda. Here, first, I will introduce the recent improvements of HDFS. Router-based federation and observer name nodes are great features for very large HDFS clusters, and data node maintenance mode, decommission monitors are great features for every HDFS cluster and its users, operators. In Yahoo Japan, we have upgraded our largest HDFS cluster to 3.3.0 and enabled HDFS Router-Based Federation, RBF. I'd like to talk about how to upgrade and how to deploy Router-Based Federation in production. When upgrading to HDFS 3.3, we faced many serious troubles. So I would like to talk about the troubles, the lessons learned from them. Okay, next slide. This picture is the overview of HDFS Router-Based Federation. In the normal HDFS client, clients will send requests to name node. However, in Router-Based Federation, clients send requests to DFS router instead of name node. DFS router acts as a proxy. When DFS router received a request from client, DFS router impersonates the client and sends that request to the name node, and then returns the response to the client. For example, a client reads a file in the DFS router sends a request to the name node. Client runs this command. DFS router sends that request to the name node corresponding to the mount point, this name node. In contrast to Vue FS-based federation, the information of the mount table is in Zookeeper state store and not in the client config. Therefore, if there is a change in the mount table, you don't have to update the config of the clients. In our environment, there are more than 1,000 monthly active users, and it is not realistic for us to update all the configs of the clients at the time when updating the mount table. Next, in addition, In contrast to Vue.fs, router-based federation can support a mount point for multiple namespaces. It means that the file and directories in the mount tables are distributed into multiple namespaces. Now, RBF supports five policies, hash, hashall, local, and space. The difference between hash and hashall is that the directory structure is considered of the directory structure of the file path is considered or not. For example, in hash, the contents in a directory is in a single subcluster, so it is the structure is considered. In contrast, in hashall, the contents in a directory can be distributed. And global quota is now available. For security, Kerberos authentication is also available in the latest 3.3 release. RBF does not support rename operation between multiple namespaces for now. So if we want to move the data between multiple namespaces, we have to manually copy data using distcp and delete the original data. In the next minor release, this CP-based balancing tool among namespaces will be available. So you can run the tool, and that's it. I think it will greatly reduce the operation costs. In addition, hard link-based rename has been developed by Xiaomi, and the patch is available in HDFS 150.87. This hard link based rename will be significantly faster than this CP because this rename does not actually move the data of the data nodes. So next, I will introduce observer name nodes. In the name normal agent, there are only one active name and one active one or and this feature is adding new observer name nodes. Observer name nodes reads the edit log from journal nodes, and they can handle a read request from the clients. When an administrator runs HI admin transition to observer command, standby name node will become observer name nodes. Similarly, administrator can run HA admin transition to standby command to make observer name node to standby. Observer name nodes are similar to standby name node, but observer name node does not participate in failover. Therefore, one or more standby name nodes are required for HA deployment. Observer name nodes support read after write consistency from single client with using transaction ID, but there is no consistency between multiple clients. In normal use cases, about 90% of the requests is read requests, so they can be handled by observer name node. So the workload of ActiveNet will be greatly reduced. It's okay. However, we have to disable access time of HDFS to reduce the workload of ActiveNameNode. If access time is enabled, read requests update access time and it is actually write requests. So the observer cannot handle those requests. So please set DFS name node access time precision to zero to disable access time in HDFS when you are deploying observer name nodes. Note that both observer name nodes and router-based federation can reduce the workload of active name node. So some of you and I would like to enable both features at the same time. But now we cannot enable them at the same time because DFS router does not support observer name nodes for now. DFS routers have internal caches to manage what name node is active or what, which name nodes is active or standby, and always send the request from clients to active name nodes. So, and the internal cache does not support observer name nodes. Next slide. So when using router-based federation or observer name node, there are multiple name nodes or DFS routers that can handle the request of the clients. In such environment, please be careful of the configuration of the clients. For example, if a client is configured as this configuration, always host one first. This is because DRH is first, and DRH means host one. It means that all the requests are handled by host one, even if both host one and host two are active. So please set DFS client failover RAND model to true to avoid such situation when using router-based federation or observer name nodes. This feature is available from Apache Hadoop 2.9, and the default value become true in Hadoop 3.4. Next minor release. The next feature I will talk about is data node maintenance mode. This picture is name node web UI, and there are three new status for data nodes: entering maintenance, in maintenance, and in maintenance and data. This is similar, very similar to decommission. Maintenance is similar to decommission, but different in the block replication factor. When a data node is decommissioned, all the blocks are freely replicated to other data nodes. It means that if the replication factor is 3, there will be 3 replicas outside of the decommissioned data nodes. In contrast, we can specify the replication factor outside of the data nodes in maintenance mode. In the most cases, the DFS name node maintenance replication mean is set to 2. This means that maintenance operation is completed when the replication factor of the blocks that the data node holds become more than 2. When there are no under-replicated blocks, maintenance mode will finish in short time. Note that if the parameter is set to 3, maintenance is the same as decommission. Decommission is good for long-term maintenance, such as replacing some hardware device of the data nodes. And the maintenance mode is good for short-term maintenance, such as kernel update and reboots. So next, I will introduce how to enter data nodes to maintenance mode. If you are going to use the feature, you need to use the new JSON-based host file format for data nodes instead of the existing format. For example, this will decommission 3, entering host 4 to maintenance mode after running DFS admin refresh nodes to the name node. The last feature I will talk about is a new decommission monitor, which is available in 3.3. The existing decommission mechanism has some problems. The biggest problem, I think, is that name node write lock become more than a few seconds when decommissioning a dense data node. This is because when adding a data node for decommission, name node write lock is held to process all blocks on the dense data node at a time. We saw more than 30 seconds of write lock when decommissioning a very dense data node that has more than 30 hard disks in our staging cluster. The second biggest problem is I/O is concentrated on a single disk of a data node. This is because decommission and maintenance is processed storage by storage, and the replication queue will process the blocks in FIFO order. There are some more problems in the existing decommission monitor, so please check HDS14854 for the details if you want to know them. We can use the new decommission monitor by setting a parameter. So the default is the existing decommission mechanism for compatibility. This picture describes how it works in short. In the new decommission monitor, there is a hash map to store the unprocessed blocks, and that way, read lock and write lock very small. The blocks in the hash map are randomized before pushing to the replication queue. That way, there are no I/O concentrated, no I/O concentration to a single disk of the data node. We have tested the new decommission monitor in the staging cluster with more than 30 data nodes, and all the write locks become less than a second. We will soon use the new decommission monitor in production. Next, I will introduce how we upgraded our largest production HDFS cluster and how we enabled router-based federation. This is the statistics of the HDFS cluster as of December last year. The number of blocks is about 300 million. And we have used HDP 2.6.x with many patches. In this cluster, there are two major existing problems. The files and directories become about 240 million, and it's near the limit that namenodes can store. This is a legendary problem with HDFS that almost all the people here know that. The problem is that to store information of the namespace and the blocks, the namenode heap size is set to hundreds of gigabytes, and we are suffering from heavy garbage collection because of its very large heap size. In addition, we had been using the very old version of Hadoop, so we want to upgrade the cluster to the latest version and split the very large namespace using router-based federation. We would like to enable router-based federation without changing any config of the clients. So we deployed DFS router in the namenode host and set the RPC port 8020 used by the existing namenode. And then the port of namenodes to other while the upgrade. That way, a client can access DFS router without any modification of the configs. Before updating the cluster, we asked some heavy users to set DFS client failover random order, which I talked before, to true to avoid concentration of RPC requests to a single DFS router. For the users who are using old clients, which do not support the parameter, we backported the future feature and provided patched client for them. The downside of this upgrade mechanism is that we cannot rolling upgrade the cluster because the RPC port of namenodes is changed. So we announced that there will be several hours of downtime. Sorry for them. Next, we consider how to split namespaces. We calculated the number of files, directories, and blocks from FS image and calculated the number of RPC calls from audit logs. RPCs are classified into write and read groups because the cost of write logs and read logs are different. Obviously, write logs are heavier than read logs. As I talked before, RBF does not support rename operation between namespaces. So we had to check the name node audit logs to ensure that there is no rename operation between namespaces. In HDFS Federation, data node can store the data of multiple namespaces. So we had to split data node for each namespace or not. The left splitting. We choose left splitting data nodes because it is more simple. There are many upsides and downsides for splitting data nodes. I will talk about them in the next slide. The upsides are that it is simple, so easier to troubleshooting operation. And I think there are no limitation of the number of namespaces. And we can easily control the replication traffic inside the data nodes of a namespaces. So this mechanism can control east-west traffic. The downsides are that we have to calculate how many data nodes required for each namespaces. For example, we need more than 200 data nodes for a namespaces, and we need more than 300 data nodes for another namespaces. If the provisioning fails, we will soon face unbalanced resource usage among namespaces. And we cannot use hard link-based rename operation, which Xiaomi is developing, because it assumes that the data nodes to be registered in multiple states clusters to use hard link. Next, when upgrading the HDFS cluster, we upgraded Java version from 8 to 11. There are many performance improvements in garbage collection between major versions, and we would like to embrace the improvements. We contributed many patches to support Java 11 in Apache Hadoop, and the support is only runtime. That means compile with Java 8 and runs on Java 11. We are contributing to Apache Hadoop to compile with Java 11. And next, we would like to support the latest Java version. For now, it means Java 15. Don't forget to upgrade Zookeeper before upgrading to Hadoop to 3.3. Hadoop 3.3 upgraded Apache Curator. This is a tool to manage. This is a tool for Zookeeper Apache version, and it depends on Zookeeper 3.5.x. We rolling upgraded our Zookeeper cluster without downtime before upgrading HDFS. It succeeded without any major problems. This is the planned schedule of the upgrades. We first upgraded the development cluster for end users to trunk, and then wait for Apache Hadoop 3.3 release. After 3.3 is released, we will upgrade the staging cluster and finally upgrade the production cluster. And this is the actual result. The schedule is delayed about 3 months, and we retried upgrades in development cluster and staging cluster because of unexpected configuration and operation errors. In production cluster, we could successfully upgrade HDFS cluster without any retries. However, we faced many troubles. I will talk about the details of the problems later. Note that the upgrades in staging and production cluster is completed at our homes due to the coronavirus situation. I will talk about the troubles we faced and lessons learned from them. This is the final part, and I think it is the main part of the presentation. For migrating the data from existing namespace to the newly added namespace, all the data has already been moved before upgrading by using this CP. And after upgrading the cluster, we have to move the latest data to the correct namespaces. This latest data is relatively smaller than the old data, but it took more than a few hours and didn't finish by the deadline. So why this CP is so slow in our environment? This CP first calculates the number of directories and files of source and destination, and then launches the MapReduce jobs to copy files in parallel. When calculating the number of directories and files, the job client connects to HDFS and runs many directory listing operations. And the calculation is not executed in parallel. And if the directory contains a lot of files, such as tens of millions of files, and directories, it takes tens of minutes or more. Increasing the number of map tasks in MapReduce job does not help reducing the execution time of the calculation because the calculation is done in single serial. And next, it fails if the number of map tasks is set to more than 200 and this CP dynamic option is true. It fails by configuration error, but unfortunately it will fail after calculating the number of files and directories. It means that it fails by configuration error after tens of minutes. We faced in production cluster. The lesson problem is that this CP does not work well for very large directory. So we recommend splitting the big job into subdirectories to make the job smaller and many jobs. Note that the configuration error is a bug in Apache Hadoop, I think, and I would like to fix it. The second problem is the worst problem. We faced many job failures just after the upgrade. The data node out traffic in a subcluster reaches the network bandwidth limit, and it caused many job failures. It means that we failed to provision the clusters. When we split the data nodes into subcluster, we considered only the data size and number of files and directories, but it is not sufficient. Read and write requests must be considered as well when splitting data nodes. To mitigate the problem, we added unused data nodes to the subcluster, but we need to completely fix that situation. So we want to improve the provisioning itself. The third problem is DFS router slowdown. DFS router drastically slowed down when restarting active name node. This picture shows the average RPC queue time of DFS router, and the queue time become more than 30 seconds when the name node is reading the FS image. This starts when it's active. And in our cluster, name node image about 15 minutes, and the slowdown lasts the time, lasts the period. And when finished reading FS image, the slowdown finished. I wrote a patch and fix doing HDS 15555. The last problem is HTTP FS incompatibilities. It is not directly related to the router-based federation, but I think it is very important for Hadoop users. In HTTP FS, the implementation of the web server is changed from Tomcat to Jetty, so the behavior is very different. For example, Tomcat does not support HTTP 1.1 chunked encoding, but Jetty supports this. The default timeout value is very different. Tomcat is 60 seconds, but Jetty is 1 second by default. We configured more idle time. And the response flow, which means fast timing, the web server returns 401 authentication required, is also different. And the response body itself is different. And many more incompatibilities. If you need to upgrade HTTP FS to Hadoop 3.x, you need to test very, very carefully with real workload. This slide is the lessons we learned from the upgrades. In this HDFS upgrades, we have changed many configurations at the same time, but it should be avoided as possible. For example, we can press to lack fault tolerant from normal precedent policy, and then under replicated blocks become 300 millions after upgrade. So the troubleshooting become more difficult. For HTTPFS, we could avoid upgrading HTTPFS and HDFS at the same time. And the last lesson is that we need to consider and imagine what will happen in production and test them as possible in advance. Ideally, there is no difference among development staging and production cluster. However, there are many differences in environments. We have to consider the differences, and there is a limit one people can imagine. So ask many colleagues to check this and consider and imagine. This is the last slide, FutureWorks. In the future, we would like to improve the situation of the federated HDFS cluster. We would like to improve the provision and rebalancing subcluster easily, and we are considering enabling multiple clusters, non-split data nodes, and so on. And we are going to enable erasure coding in production. We have upgraded only the HDFS, and YARN is still old, so we have to backport feature to the old HDFS clients. The backport work is mostly finished. Now we have upgraded Java version to 11, so we can use new low pause time GC algorithms such as ZGC and Shenandoah GC. We would like to experiment these algorithms. My presentation is finished. Any questions? So the question one is, why choose to upgrade to 3.3? This is because Kerberos authentication is available in router-based federation. We are enabling Kerberos authentication in all the Hadoop clusters, so this security is required. We don't face, the question is, did you have any trouble reading data that was written by HDFS 2.7 after the upgrade to HDFS 3.3? The answer is that we did not face any trouble reading data that was written by HDFS 2.7. So as I mentioned in the screen, the display is we experimented more than a year in development cluster, so we can do it. The next question is, as you deployed in RBF in production, which is one more layer, what's latency impact for applications? There is a big impact for application because of the data node traffic. So the latency is not a big problem because we are facing more bigger problems. The next, it seems like router and name node was pressed on the same host on different ports to make it easier to migrate to RBF. Was there any other benefit for doing this? Or was it just for ease of migration? This is just for ease of migration. We want to avoid for performance reasons. We want to separate DFS router and name node. So for performance and operation. So we would like to gradually move DFS router to separate hosts. The next question is, what's the suggested number of the routers for one namespace? So this migration, before the name node is two, active name node and one standby name node, so DFS router is pressed on the same host and the same port. So DFS router is now two. The number of DFS router is now two. I would like to suggest the number of the router will be more than two, for example, three or four to rolling upgrade. If there is only two DFS router, when configuration we want to change the configuration, then restart the DFS router one by one. So when restarting router, the request is concentrated to one DFS router. So there will be three or more DFS router ideally. The next question is, do you see any bottleneck on RBF or Zookeeper on High Road. So after upgrading name no, our HDFS cluster, Zookeeper watch count will increase it increased too much, but it is not a bottleneck. There is a patch to eliminate watch for Zookeeper so Zookeeper delegation token manager. So if you want, if you are going to upgrade to 3.3.1 next bug fix release or applying a patch, watch count will be greatly reduced. So could I answer all the questions? Okay. There was analysis done on FS image and audit logs to understand how the clusters can be split behind the router to understand read and write patterns and etc. This seems to be a common problem as we more companies adopt RBFS. Thank you for explanations. So I think it's true. Okay. The next question is, I mean, name node can process 10 of thousands operations per second with 5 milliseconds. After introducing router, and router also can take 5 milliseconds, then throughput can decrease to 5. Okay. So the throughput itself cannot decrease because So I do not think the latency becomes larger, but the throughput will not decrease. And a single router can handle tens of operations per second, and the name node can process about 10 of thousands of operations per second, and therefore in RBF environment, DFS router can process more than tens of hundreds of operations per second. The question is, with open source router, or do you have some private changes? We don't change the open source implementations, and backporting some patches into our router. Such as this. So there are no private changes. A very good question. Before upgrading, what was the overall strategies for data node, fleet-wide, reboot, kernel upgrades without maintenance mode feature? Do you drain the entire host before rebooting kernel upgrade? Yes. So we have to decommission the data nodes to upgrade kernel versions. So it's very slow. So maintenance mode will be very great feature for us. Thank you, Eric. Is there any remaining questions? So I'm looking forward to know next year. Thank you. We are using RBFS security, and it's very good. Thank you, Huey. Hey. Thank you, Richard. Thank you, Matt. So it's 4:41 a.m. in Japan. So next I will sleep. Thank you, Uma. And thank you, Brahma. Good night.